डॉक्टर मंडी प्लीज, डॉक्टर उषा सिंह, डॉक्टर उषा सिंह, सो वी वुड लाइक टू गो फॉर द लैक्रिमल फ्री पेपर सेशन. वी हैव गॉट द चेयरपर्सन एज नन अदर देन डॉक्टर ए के ग्रोवर, को चेयरपर्सन मनदीप सिंह बाजाज. I am Dr. Vijay Goswami. I will convene, and it will be moderated by Dr. Parveen Kumar Mangri. We request all the speakers to load the papers if it is not loaded, because time is very short. And we request the first speaker to come, Dr. Mukesh Kumar Khare.
Can we first check who, which all of the speakers are here? We'll start with the first one. Dr. Mukesh Khare is here. Dr. Dr. Ravindra Kumar Chaudhary. Thank you. Dr. Rupa. Dr.
Ruchi Goyal is here.
Dr. Ruchi Goyal is here. Dr. D.N. Prakash.
Dr. Your Mukesh, name is, in the meantime, please come.
Your name is? You will be presenting. Okay. And Dr. Shantanu Mitra.
Dr. Shantanu Mitra.
Dr. Okay, we'll. Bhavesh Saha. Dr. Bhagyesh Fore. Yes. Dr. Satyam Gupta and Dr. Shreya. So we have a very interesting session ahead. We have some surgical, some about diseases, some about innovation. So we look forward to some very nice presentations. But please stick to your timing, because as you know, the important thing is in a competitive section that timing must be stuck to. So we look forward to some nice talks. We start with Dr. Mukesh Khare. We have a request from Dr. Shreya Shah. She has to present in another session, so we'll have her as the second speaker.
Is it a 4 minutes? Yeah. Time allotted.
Yes, please.
Yes.
My dear chairperson, fellow delegates, the present study is inspired by dentistry.
Okay, we will note on the time.
When I was getting my teeth scan done by CBCT, JCT.
The cone beam computed tomography dedicated to dentistry. Persistent epiphora with patent syringing is a diagnostic dilemma. Various modalities are available to investigate such cases, but none of them uncover the exact pathology. With this background, we designed this study to compare CBCT DCG with conventional DCG and to evaluate the role of CBCT DCG in patients of persistent epiphora with patent syringing. 198 eyes were randomly divided into two groups after taking informed consent, while in one group, dye was injected in inferior canaliculus. In the other group, dye was instilled into conjunctival cul-de-sac. I repeat, dye was instilled into conjunctival cul-de-sac, and the scan was taken after 3 minutes, and if needed, after 15 and 30 minutes. This is the CBCT machine. The patients remain seated comfortably, blinks normally, the dye is instilled in conjunctival cul-de-sac, and the machine takes 13 seconds to complete the scanning. The CBCT images were further classified into three groups. Number one, patent group, where the dye was visualized in inferior meatus after 3 minutes. The delayed patency group, where the dye was visualized after 15 or 30 minutes, and the mechanical obstruction group where the dye was not visualized even after 30 minutes. And in conventional group, there is patent and non-patent. All the images were analyzed by me and the dental radiologist. As with any CBCT imaging, the CBCT provides coronal sections, sagittal sections, axial section, and the reconstructed 3D view. Here is the coronal sections at different level of same patient, showing the flow of dye through nasolacrimal duct. And these are the 3D images viewed from different angles. You can see the canaliculi, common canaliculus, sac, nasolacrimal duct, and even the intraosseous part of the nasolacrimal duct after skimming. The low percentage of patent patients in CBCT group is because of the delayed patency patients. A patient of persistent epiphora with patent syringing, after 3 minutes, dye is visualized only in lacrimal sac area, while after 30 minutes, dye was visualized in inferior meatus with gross pooling of dye in lower part of the nasolacrimal duct, indicating the presence of stricture at lower down area. A patient, both sides operated for DCR. Here the first dye traveled up to the level of obstruction and then it started trickling through the anastomosis into middle meatus. In the last image, you can trace the path taken by dye to reach the nasal antrum. CBCT DCG can be easily done in children without the need of any anesthesia or sedation. We have done in 3-year-old baby. Here is a patient, mucosal on right side, please focus on left side. Left side had persistent epiphora. We did the conventional DCG and it revealed that it is patent. We called the patient next day. We did the CBCT DCG and see, after 30 minutes, the dye has traveled only up to the upper part of nasolacrimal duct. And then we injected the dye and it has gone into the inferior meatus. This is the difference between the conventional and the CBCT DCG. CBCT DCG is purely physiological. The anatomical details provided by CBCT DCG and the cost make it superior to scintigraphy, though the both tests are physiological. And back to our original patient. In this patient, CBCT DCG revealed kinking at the junction of nasolacrimal duct and the sac, and that was the responsible for the persistent epiphora, which could be easily negotiated by syringing. Hence, I can say it is 100% physiological, new technique, non-invasive, cheap, gives very good anatomical details, and it is very helpful in cases of persistent epiphora with patent syringing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mukesh, for a very interesting work. A couple of questions.
Yeah.
One is, what is the radiation dose that you give in?
Sir, in patient 13 to 15, microsievert radiation is released. It is less than the what in scintigraphy, or even less than in the it is less to the conventional dactylocystography.
Okay. Second is, can you do the physiological way of testing with the drops alone in with conventional CT scan? And does this cone?
No, offer without this machine you can't do this.
Why? Don't you get?
Because the patient is in the sitting position here and we are not injecting the dye. Whenever the patient is lying down, we have got to inject the dye. Only because of this machine, which is being used now in dentistry very commonly.
Okay.
So because of the sitting posture, it is good.
And as compared to scintigraphy?
Sir, so the anatomical details are poor with scintigraphy. All of us have seen the scintigraphy. And the cost, it cost only 2,000 bucks for this test. Scintigraphy costs 30,000 bucks.
Thank you. Any questions from the...
So, in case there is a block proximal to the NLD, right?
I mean,
like you said, there was a block at the junction of the sac and NLD. So suppose there is a block proximal to that, I mean, at the canalicular, common canalicular level. So would the contrast medium still go into that area by the capillary action?
Yes, sir. I have shown the pictures, 3D pictures, or even the coronal sections. Where if you permit me, I will show you.
No, it's okay. I mean,
that's it beautifully illustrates all the canaliculi to the tip of the nasal aqueduct.
That was my main concern, actually. Yeah.
Right. Dr. Rabindra Chaudhary.
Thank you.
Next
I'm extremely grateful to Dr. Grover sir to allow me to present earlier, and I apologize all other speakers. Modified pigtail technique, unique for cost effectiveness, repair of canalicular laceration, and I have no financial interest in it. Later repair with repair of canalicular laceration that requires the stent to make a position of epithelialized canalicular system for the drainage. Available options for that are many, like silicon tube, Teflon sleeve of intracath, any other non-absorbable sutures, etc. But the most important and the difficult part is finding out the lost end of the canaliculus from all this mess. Finding the lost end of the canaliculus, we have certain options like looking for Fleringa's ring, fluorescein dye injection, methylene blue injection, railroad technique, and of course the pigtail probe technique. But if you look at pigtail probe technique, it is quite traumatic. The video is not playing. It is quite traumatic, and sometimes you are feeling that it's a very, very big pigtail probe and you are not able to pass through the non-traumatic end of canaliculus. Based on the classical pigtail probe design, came an idea of creating non-traumatic thin probe which can carry stent material along with it. So the 50 proline needle with 3/8 circle came in my mind. We have done this technique in 10 patients. Videos. That's okay, I'll just put this presentation. Is it okay? It will run now. Mainly I have videos only. Yeah, I'll just go fast. So after just careful examination where the lost end, and if you are not able to find out the lost end after careful examination, just secure the other proximal end which you are able to see. Then just take a 4-0 after dilatation of non-traumatized punctum. We have taken 4-0 proline suture needle after making it blunt. We have made it blunt on table with mosquito forceps, and we carry emery stone in our lead drum also. So after making it blunt, now the pigtail design is ready for us. Here we have to loose in between. We cannot just continue pushing, otherwise it may create the false passage. But it's blunt end, so it's very easy to take it out. You don't have to find it. It has to come to the lost end of the canaliculus, and that same thing you can pass through other end. So after tying both the ends, we can suture pericanalicular tissue and sliding the knot in the canaliculus itself. So this is post-op the same patient. We have done same technique in pediatric patient also. So the same way, after making the needle blunt, after dilatation of the punctum, we made the needle blunt and passed the proline 5-0 suture. And we can see that when it comes out, now we are able to see that Floringa ring when it comes out. So it's very easy to pass
slides
out.
Dekho, slides kyun nahi move kar raha? Dr. Shea, slides are not coming on the screen.
Oh my God.
Just check. And your time is actually running.
अभी क्या करूँ? कनेक्टर लगा भी। अब मैं पेन ड्राइव में बीजू प्रेजेंटेशन अपलोड करने लगाई थी तो।
So that is the reason it is always best to, you know, load it in the central
loading
system. We have
already loaded, sir. It's not playing. So I just wanted to say it's a cost effective, easily available, very, very less learning curve, and it's of course available at any with anybody in the. And we have studied this technique in 10 patients, 6 adults and 4 children.
They can come.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
No, please see if we can get the slide.
It's a laptop hang.
Laptop hang. Thank you, sir. बंद कर देना बेल ऐप बेल प्रेजेंटेशन चालू से नेट ले पेन ड्राइव और चलाई जैसे तो बेल बंद करना पड़ता है पेन ड्राइव है आपके लैपटॉप में कर लो ये पेन ड्राइव
सर इन द मीन टाइम
पेन ड्राइव है आपके लैपटॉप में कर लो अमन आती बराबर पेन ड्राइव शेयर
कैन यू आस्क डॉक्टर रविंद्र टू कम ओवर एंड यू प्लीज करेक्ट इट देयर एंड कम अगेन प्लीज
इसमें ऑलरेडी है ना ऑलरेडी डाला है ना
प्रेजेंटेशन कैरीज मार्क्स इसमें हम देखो अच्छा लिमिटेड टाइम एंड एक्सेप्टेबिलिटी उस ड्रामेटिकली एवरीथिंग में भी
आई डोंट हैव टू जज ना
नो 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 वेरी सेफ पेपर
आई डोंट टू
यू हैव टू गिव मार्क्स टू एवरीवन यू डोंट यू हैव टू पेपर
Thank you so much, sir. So this is the, it's very difficult to find out the lost end. So after careful inspection and examination, you can see this patient is third day post-op cataract and he got an injury. So after that, just dilate the non-traumatic end and secure what you are able to see. Okay. So other end is secured. To find out that end, we have made 5-0 proline suture needle blunt on table with mosquito forceps, and we carry the emery stone and we make it blunt. So now, after making it blunt, the needle is ready. After dilatation of non-traumatized punctum, just push the needle. Here, don't push the needle, leave your hand in between, let the needle guide you and don't guide the passage, otherwise we may create the false passage. But still the needle is blunt, so it's not likely to get the false passage. Again and again, observe from which end the needle is coming out. So it becomes exactly pigtail technique. And we can see the needle has come out through the cut end of the canaliculus. The same needle has got proline in it, so we can pass through the other end, tie the knot, and again slide the knot. After that, we can repair the pericanalicular tissue as usual, what we do, and secure the end, and passing the knot into the canaliculus. So this is my post-operative results. We have done same technique in children also. Here also, it's a fully avulsed medial part of the lead. It's very difficult to find out the cut end. So same technique we have used. Here we have used 6-0 proline suture and made the needle blunt on table, pass through it. Once you're passing the needle through it, even if you're not able to see Flaringa's ring, but when we can see here clear, it, the needle, other part of the needle is coming out of the Flaringa's ring itself. So it says that this is the cut end of the canaliculus only. So we sutured it, and pericanalicular tissue also sutured after that. So post-operatively, systemic antibiotic prescribed. All patients followed up for 3 days, 1 week, 2 weeks, 6 weeks, 6 weeks, and 3 months. Stent removed and again followed up to 6 months and 1 year. We have done this technique in 10 patients. These are the results of my patients, 6 adults and 5 children. So all are doing very well. So the advantage of this technique is it's cost effective, easily available, easy technique, less learning curve, surety of finding the proximal end, and no other stent material is required. The disadvantage is initial epiphora because of knot, if it is touching to cornea, corneal abrasion in some of the patient. This is a very strong suture, so sometimes shaving of the roof of canaliculus can happen if child rubs the eye too much, and infection,
go,
of course.
Please go to the last.
So the conclusion is the reported method is a unique technique to repair, which is very cost effective, easy to adapt, and assures the excellent result without much discomfort to the patient. Current procedure is an alternative solution in a silicone tube is also, if it is not available. These are my references. Thanks to my teachers. Thanks to my patients. Thank you.
Any questions?
Yes.
Please.
You straight away took these patients for this technique, or you first tried to identify the end?
It's a very large trauma care center, so we have done lots of work in trauma, and we identify with all different techniques, but this I found very easy and effective.
These you first tried to identify only in those cases where you couldn't identify the other end. You use this technique? Or
yeah, I try to see. After observation, if you are able to see Flaringa's ring, no need to do anything. But still, you have to put some stent. Stent you have to put
only
anyhow.
For the sake of a putting stent, you have used this technique?
No. To finding out the other end also. And along with that, you don't have to spend other time and money for the stent. So it comes along with that.
Now, identification is anyway important. We cannot do it blindly.
Another
thing. Anyway,
yeah, it's important, sir.
How blunt was the tip end? Because you yourself have seen in the concluding slides that damage to the canalicular structure has been very common.
So if it is not made blunt, it can happen. So we keep embryo torn in our drum itself, and we make it blunt, and we observe carefully in a microscope. So once it is non-traumatic, then only we pass the things.
The video you just had broken the tip and you have passed.
No, I have not broken. I have made the emery stone. I made it blunt also, sir.
What is the caliber of proline that you have used? What thickness?
6-0 proline. 5-0 and 6-0 proline. 6-0 in pediatric and 5-0 in adult.
Thank you,
sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Dr. Kusana, please call the next.
Yes, sir, twice. Which one? Yeah. This one?
Ultimately, Dr. Rabindra Choudhury.
Respected dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, a very good afternoon to all of you. I will be discussing today rhinosporidiosis of lacrimal sac in a tertiary care hospital of India, a retrospective case series. Rhinosporidiosis is a chronic and localized infection of mucous membrane. It can affect nose, nasopharynx, eye, skin, and genitalia. Ocular involvement is seen in 15% of the cases. Among ocular involvement, conjunctiva is the commonest site. Involvement of lacrimal sac is rare and reported to be 26% of total ocular involvement. It is caused by an organism called Rhinosporidium severi, an aquatic protistan parasite of fish and amphibia. This parasite mainly thrives in hot and tropical climates, mainly seen in India, Nepal, parts of East Africa and South America. The climate of Odisha is moderate, however, extreme climatic condition is seen in the western part of Odisha, where the study was done. With this background, the aim of our study was to study the clinical profiles and management of lacrimal sac rhinosporidiosis. This was a retrospective study conducted during a period of 2 years. 24 cases presenting with boggy swelling of the lacrimal sac area and proven as rhinosporidiosis on histology were included. The study staffs were included 4 ophthalmologists and 2 pathologists. The inter-observer variations was avoided by standard clinical definition to suspect lacrimal sac rhinosporidiosis and a standard histological definition to confirm it. For each patient entering into the study, the details, epidemiology, clinical features, and treatments were studied and analyzed. Special attention was given to collect information regarding bathing habits of all the cases. All the patients were referred to ENT specialist to look for any nasal involvement. Decrocystectomy was done in each case. 5% povidone iodine was applied to surgical field for 5 minutes in all of our cases. Care was taken to avoid spilling of spores. Postoperatively, all of our patients were given Depson in a dose of either 100 mg twice daily for 3 to 6 months, after excluding G6PD deficiency in each of the cases. All the patients were followed up for 1 year. Coming to the age distributions, most of the cases were less than 10 years of age, and male to female ratio was 1:1. Boggy swelling of the lacrimal sac area was found to be the commonest manifestations, followed by epiphora, epistaxis, and polypoidal growth in the lacrimal sac area. All the cases were uniocular in nature. All the patients had a history of taking bath in pond water. Neither nasal involvement nor any conjunctival involvement was associated with any of our patients. On opening the sac, pink vascularized growth with finger-like extensions loaded with white dots were seen, and the lesion was intraluminal in 66% of the cases, whereas it is extend outside the lacrimal sac in 33% of the cases, and bleeding was very remarkable during excisions. Recurrence was found to be one of the most common postoperative complication, and it was noted 25% in our case series. This is a case of lacrimal sac rhinosporidiosis presenting with the boggy swelling of the lacrimal sac area. This is a histopathology of the Rhinosporidium severi showing sporangia in different phases of maturations. This is a case of polypoidal growth over the lacrimal sac area studded with whitish dot. This is a case of recurrence of lacrimal sac rhinosporidiosis with subcutaneous spread. Coming to the discussion, lacrimal sac rhinosporidiosis is usually suspected when a patient present with the boggy swelling of the lacrimal sac regions as reported by the different literatures. Boggy swelling and epiphora was found with the 2 common manifestations of our study, whereas Nuruddin et al., they found epistaxis is one of the important event in their manifestations. Only 1/4 of our patients presented epiphora in spite of the lacrimal sac involvement in each of our cases. The probable reason may be spread of infection is pericanalicular and perisacular instead of intraluminal. So part of the sac remains patent. That's the reason we encountered less epiphora. We found less than 10 years as a common involvement, whereas Nuruddin et al., they have found 25 to 34 years as the common age. Sac ratio is 1:1 in our study, and it was 3.5:1 in them. History of pond bath was 100% in our study, whereas it was 66% in them. Other mode of transmission as reported by different literatures are air and dust, but the probable route of entry to lacrimal sac in our study is canaliculi and nasolacrimal duct. In spite of this, no nasal and conjunctival involvement in our series is an interesting variation. Pushkar et al. Has done CT decrocystography to delineate the nasolacrimal sac involvement and canalicular involvement, but we did not do any such investigation to avoid harmful effect of radiations. DCT is advocated by all of the authors for the standard mode of management for lacrimal sac rhinosporidiosis. However, Nuruddin et al. have advocated modified DCR techniques, and in them they have found less recurrence, about 11.1%. However, in our study we encountered 25% of recurrence. The reason for less recurrence in our studies probably meticulous dissections with proper intraoperative and postoperative measures and limited period of follow-up. Intraoperative applications of 5% betadine, electric cauterizations of the surrounding healthy areas, application of 1 to 5 ml of amphotericin B have been tried by different authors to prevent recurrence. Postoperatively also Dapsone has been tried as it arrests maturations of the spores and promotes fibrosin in stroma by different authors. We strongly believe that intraoperative povidone iodines and postoperative Dapsone therapy have lessened the recurrence in our series. So to conclude, lacrimal sac rhinosporidosis is very rare globally. In this part of Odisha, it is quite common. Children with history of pond baths are found to be commonly affected. They commonly present with boggy swelling of the lacrimal sac area. Recurrence is the main postoperative complications. However, can be lessened by the intraoperative betadine and postoperative Dapsone therapy. These are my references. And thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. Any questions from the panel, from the chairpersons? Any question from the audience? Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Let's have the presentation from the next speaker. We'll request Dr. Ruchi Goyal to kindly present her bill.
So good afternoon, everybody. I shall be presenting on evaluation of transclavicular laser DCR in the management of acute dacryocystitis. Stagnation, nasolacrimal duct obstruction leads to stagnation of fluid that leads to bacterial overgrowth and acute dacryocystitis. We all know that it presents as a rapid onset of pain, swelling below the medial canthal area. If neglected, it can lead to orbital cellulitis, orbital abscess, superior ophthalmic vein thrombosis, and meningitis. If external DCR is performed in this acute stage, it can lead to infection in tissue, planes, septicemia, excessive bleeding, and wound give. So what we do is we do percutaneous drainage of lacrimal sac, give systemic antibiotics, and once the inflammation subsides, we go for external DCR. However, incision and drainage per se leads to recurrences. Why does it happen is because we are not eliminating the root cause and the stagnation continues. So the patient may end up with a fistula, there is prolonged morbidity. So what came to my mind was that if we create an initial osteotomy along with aspiration of pus instead of an incision and drainage, would it be a better alternative? Should a small osteotomy be created initially and enlarged at a later stage when the inflammation has settled down? So lot of endoscopic DCR methods have been tried, but there is no standard protocol as of now. So I decided to conduct this study, and we did a pilot study on 45 patients who presented to us. They were randomly divided into three groups. First thing was that we aspirated the pus and we sent it for culture and sensitivity. After this, in all the three groups, an initial opening was made 4 by 4 millimeter in size using a 980 nanometer diode laser. And later on, this was enlarged to 8 by 8 millimeter using a surgical method, made by endoscopically putting a Blake's lace forceps, as in group 1 and group 2. The difference in group 1 and group 2 was that in group 1, the whole thing was performed in a single stage, whereas in group 2, it was done, the enlargement was done after 10 days. In group 3, on the other hand, the enlargement of the osteotomy was done by an external DCR approach to 8 by 8 millimeter. All the patients received systemic antibiotics in the form of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid and topical antibiotics, serratio peptidase. We did not give pain relievers per se. We, because we wanted to do the pain scoring as well. Patients in group 2 and group 3 also received additional course of antibiotics because of the second stage of the surgery. Now, we found that the maximum patients present with painful swelling and epiphora along with fistula, the mean age group was 45, and the male-female ratio, of course, 1:2. And the average number of episodes were 2.96. What we see in group one was that the pain scores were much higher than in group two and group three. However, the pain scores decreased tremendously by group four in all the three groups. This could be the early resolution would be because of the relief in the stagnation leading to augmentation of the effect of antibiotics, and that may have caused dramatic effects. In stage one procedures, there were two burns, and you can see this burn had to be relieved by multiple dressings for 10 days. There was excessive bleeding. There was more periorbital edema in stage one vis-a-vis where it was done in two stages. There were no difference in post-op complications. There were 20% patients with positive staph aureus in our group, and all these were resistant to amoxicillin. The bacterial resistance to penicillin has also been shown by other authors. We had anatomical success of 100% all three groups, but in group one, that is the in group two, it was 86.6% vis-a-vis group three. We had all these functional failures were due to some syndrome which occurred between 10 to 14 days. And if we compare it with other studies, Christie et al. Had similar results as our group. Lombardi had a better success rate, but this they talked about only anatomical success, not functional success. There was no some syndrome in endosurgical DCR. Why? Because in surgical DCR, you completely lay open the sac, so there are, the chances of some are much less. So to conclude, a blanket treatment with penicillin should be avoided, and a tailor-made antibiotic approach is the way to success. Establishment of patency is to be done so that it helps in earlier resolution of the symptoms, so that you can go for external DCR at an earlier stage. It will also prevent fistula formation, and a single stage has a similar success as two stage, but is fraught with more complications. If a second stage has to be performed, the enlargement should be done after 14 weeks, or a vigorous follow-up should be done so that if any blockage occurs, it is relieved. A vertical extent of opening should cover the entire length of the distended sac, because these patients may have very enlarged sacs, and this will improve our functional outcome in these patients. We did not use any MMC or did any intubation, and our results were similar to those who had used MMC and intubation. And so to conclude, nowadays, whatever patient of acute dacryocystitis come, whether you are able to do anything or not, the first thing that I do is I create a laser osteotomy and give send a pus culture sensitivity and do my surgery later. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ritchie. How did you choose your 14 weeks period? What basis?
I did not choose, sir. It was my study that, what I observed was all my patients, they started having some syndrome between 10 and 14 weeks. All my patients, I did the second stage after 10 days, assuming the fact that by that time the inflammation would have settled. But then, to contrary to what I thought, it was that basically the whatever is going to happen, it happens during this phase. So maybe, just the 10-day period is not sufficient. Either I need to follow them up more rigorously, and if the augmentation has to be done, it has to be done at a later stage. It's not,
So you can only conclude that 10 days period is possibly
not enough.
Not
why,
adequate.
Why
you can't
14
conclude
weeks?
That 14 is okay.
Why 14 weeks?
Yes, sir. That's what this was the time when the sump was occurring.
Okay.
Now, from this study, you can't conclude that additional MMC or intubation does
not. No, I said that they were comparable. I said my results were comparable with those who had used. I did not say that, they are of no use.
So it cannot be a conclusion of this study.
Yes, sir.
It can be an inference.
Inference, yes, sir.
In your discussion.
Yes, sir.
How difficult it was to pass through the common canalicular end at
yes,
the
sir.
Time of acute inflammation.
Sir, that's the best part of laser DCR. Even if you're not able to visualize anything, once you aspirate that pus, if you can pass your probe, you can pass your diode laser.
Passing the probe is difficult in most of the time.
Acute dacryocystitis, probe passing is not difficult. It is basically the rest of the surgical procedure which becomes painful, because passing probe, we did not have problem in any of these patients. Once you give the block, the patients are settled.
A question from the audience.
So this is endoscopic DCR, that's what I'm saying altogether. This is endoscopic, this is laser. This is surgical augmentation of laser TCR. This is, the augmentation was done endoscopically only. See, there are myriad modalities of, so that's a big, you know, whole thing, whole discussion. Endoscopic DCR basically can be a laser DCR. It can be endoscopic surgical DCR.
I think that would go beyond the purview of our discussion.
Yeah.
So we will maybe confine it for some other day. Maybe we can have the next person. Thank you, Dr. Ritchie.
Dr. Sujata, please.
DN Prakash. Paper 5.
On his behalf. Is
have it? You informed the Chairman Scientific Committee that you will be presenting this
letter? Yes, sir, we have got
it. It was informed from
Good afternoon, everybody. My topic is role of 2% rebapimide ophthalmic suspension in the management of dry eye syndrome. My All India conference number is S20410. According to DIU's 2 classification, dry eye was again defined, it has a multifactorial disease with adding some few terms like loss of homeostasis of the tear film and accompanied by ocular symptoms in which tear film instability, hyperosmolarity, ocular surface inflammation and damage played an important role, accompanied by neurosensory abnormality which also plays a etiological role. As you can see, in Asian countries, prevalence of dry eye syndrome is more when compared to American and Australian countries. So it has a negative impact on the patient's quality of life with potential sight-threatening consequences. So there were many newer drugs so that we can address directly to the etiology of the drugs, not just improving the symptoms of the dry eye. So rebapimide was one such novel quinolone derivative. It is a mucin secretagogue initially marketed in Japan for the management of gastric mucosal diseases like gastric ulcers. It was launched in Japan in 2012 for the treatment of dry eye. It increases the secretion of both membrane-associated and secreted type mucins through mucin production in the conjunctival goblets and corneal epithelial cells. Also, it acts by suppressing the production of inflammatory cytokines, which is also one of the etiological factors in dry eye syndrome. So, as you can see, in core mechanism of the dry eye syndrome is mainly tear osmolarity, hyperosmolarity, inflammatory mediators, apoptosis, tear instability. So, it acts in it. Rebapimide acts the drug in different at the different levels at 4 modes. It increases the secreted and membrane-associated mucins, also prevents the damage of microvilli, increases the production of goblet cells, and also decreases the tear hyperosmolarity. Only the rare adverse effect seen with rebapimide was bitter taste, so it has to be approved for use in the USA. Its safety and efficacy has been established in clinical trials and some experimental reports. So in this observational study, we evaluate the study effect of 2% rebapimide ophthalmic suspension in the patients with dry eye syndrome. So it was the objective was to study the therapeutic effect of 2% rebapimide ophthalmic suspension in dry eye disease. It included 50 patients with observation and prospective study. All the diagnosed cases of dry eyes for a minimum period of 6 months and willing to participate in the study were included. Presence of infective pathology, patients using other topical medications, use of contact lens and history of ocular surgery were excluded. The diagnosis of dry eye was based on the diagnostic criteria of dry eye research group. Complete ocular surface examination and anterior segment examination was done with slit lamp. At baseline, 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 8 weeks and 12 weeks follow-up was done. First, tear breakup film, T-butt measurement, shimmer test and injuries related to the dry eye subjects were performed. And all the patients diagnosed with dry eye were prescribed 2% ophthalmic suspension to be administered 4 times a day and follow-up was made. So our results were, total 50 patients were included. Majority of the patients were between 51 to 60 years, like it is a more of elderly patients disease, with women's being more about 61%. So on dry eye symptom score, all the parameters related to dry eye were decreased, like they improved when from baseline to the like summarizing mean dry eye related symptom score showed significant improvement from baseline to 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 8 weeks and 12 weeks. Median fluorescein ocular surface staining also showed significant improvement from baseline. T-butt and shimmers, they also showed improvement, but the improvement was not that significant. So subjective symptoms like foreign body sensation, feeling of dryness, photophobia showed improvement from baseline to 6 weeks. Such improvements in symptom score contribute to the improved quality of life in patients with dry eye. This was compared to the study conducted by Uda et al., which showed that mean dry eye symptom score showed significant improvement from baseline. And fluorescein ocular surface staining also showed significant improvement from the baseline. Kinishita et al. Also showed improvement from the baseline. That is 1% and both 1% and 2% rebapivirimod was successful in improving the fluorescein ocular surface score. An increase in mucin-like substance in the cornea and conjunctiva was observed in preclinical studies. Tear breakup film breakup time also improved, and it also showed the improvement in corneal higher order abrasion, cornea coma-like abrasion, and spherical-like abrasion after the application of the rebapivirimod. It was compared to the study conducted by Koha et al. Shimmer test showed improvement, but it was not significant. This was also similar to the study conducted by Uda et al. And Kinishita et al. Concluding, 2% rebapivirimod ophthalmic suspension is an effective treatment for the dry eye. The improvement of ocular surface condition after its application is remarkable for the patients, especially in severe condition. And well-tolerated profile of the rebapivirimod makes it potentially useful treatment option for the dry eye. So, moreover, this drug has a great potential to change the framework of treatment for ocular surface disorder in the future. These are my references. Thank you.
Did you have any controls of any kind?
No, sir. It was
observation. How can you draw a conclusion that it has the possibility of revolutionizing treatment?
When compared to baseline, only rebapivirimod drug was used, and no any other drugs were used. And previously, 6 months they had symptoms of dry eye. So when we started with new drug, they showed improvement from.
The studies should have a control.
Control.
What is new in your study?
What is new in your study? Because this is what the company also claims. Did you
there are not much studies
did you
in.
You classify your dry eyes.
Guidelines.
Dry eye
classification.
No, sir. Mainly, I didn't take the etiology as such, like mild, moderate, severe. Yes, sir. I classified.
You have taken all the aqueous deficiency as well as evaporated dry eye together.
Yes, sir. Like mainly symptomatic wise, I have taken, sir. Whoever are diagnosed, mainly aqueous deficient patients were taken into the study, not mucin associated. Mainly aqueous deficient patients.
In your criteria, you didn't take the OPI. Do you know what is OPI? Mm. In dry eye, nowadays, ocular protection index is a very major criteria.
No, sir.
You didn't take
it. No, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
One of the drugs being tried, that one. One of the drugs being tried.
Next. Speaker is Dr.
Keynote address.
We are going for the keynote address by Dr. Rashmi Kumari. Dr. Rashmi Kumari. In her absence, we'll go to Dr. Shantanu Mitra. Has he come?
No, he is
he's
not come.
Absent. No. Now he might come. Dr. Bhavesh Saha,
absent.
Dr. B.B.
Pore.
B.B. Pore.
Good afternoon to the all the delegates and dignitaries on the dais. So the my study is pointing towards the very I can say that it is a rare condition, but it very rarely managed and commonly misdiagnosed condition. Acute canaliculitis. The current talk is pertaining to acute kidney irregularities on all counts. Financial disclosure, we have no financial disclosures to be made. My membership number is B11424. Introduction to acute canaliculitis. Acute canaliculitis is commonly misdiagnosed and wrongly treated condition. It mimics thigh, foreign body granuloma, dacryocystitis also sometimes. Symptoms like patient usually present with chronicity, absence of pain, epiphora, swelling at the inner canthal area, mucopurulent discharge in spite of medical treatment. Signs we can get are usually non-tender swelling. Pouting punctum is a characteristic sign we get of acute canaliculitis. Usually patients are roplas negative. Patient is having adjoining area chronic conjunctivitis and expression of the one or more concretions on pressure. This is a very characteristic appearance, clinical appearance of the canaliculitis condition. Pathogens like staphylococcus, streptococcus, actinomyces, Israeli colonies in the form of concretion resides in the ampulla of the canaliculus. The etiogenesis can be long-term use of punctal plugs, and early diagnosis and complete surgical curettage of the ampulla is the crux of treatment. So the aim of the study is acute lacrimal canaliculitis, clinical profile, microbiological profile we studied, their influence on the management outcome, and outline the correct management. Case series of 18 patients with 18 eyes treated for acute canaliculitis. Each case was posted for canaliculotomy till the delivery of last concretion with the help of 2 or 3 SNP procedure, followed by curettage of the ampulla and systemic antibiotics. Some steps: local infiltrating anesthesia, punctum dilated, first SNP on the vertical segment of the canaliculus, second SNP on the lid margin, and third SNP to excise the triangle and thus to complete canaliculotomy. With the use of canalization clamp, canaliculus is milked till the last concretion gets delivered. Diluted iodine solution applied with the stick swab. Syringing attempted if it is possible, otherwise it is attempted at the day 7. Systemic antibiotic is were given amoxicillin clavulanic combination. Surgical video we will move to at the end of the session, end of the talk.
One more one.
This is the clinical outcome with a wide open punctum and abolishment of the disease. Coming to the results, mean age of presentation was 36 with female predominance. Patients presented with common symptoms of epiphora and common sign was pouting punctum. Lower canaliculus was more commonly involved, and mean delay in the diagnosis was observed on the history was 15 months due to false impression. Out of 16 culture positive specimens, majority specimens grown staphylococcus and streptococcus, and in some cases we got actinomyces also. Syringing after 1 week was found patent. In 48 months follow-up, no recurrence was observed. So to conclude, awareness among the treating eye surgeon regarding the entity is of utmost importance to diagnose the canaliculitis. Microbiological profile plays a crucial role if the services are available. Identifying the pathogen and thereby delivering the focus therapy also helpful for epidemiological point of view. To continue, procedures like canaliculotomy with curettage confer the full resolution of the entity without prevailing delay if diagnosed in time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pure, for a well-documented series. What is the additional addition that it is doing to our knowledge?
As far as a general ophthalmic point of view is concerned, not as an oculoplastic surgeon, I want to highlight some important facts regarding the acute canaliculitis. Majority of the cases, they have been advised to undergo DCR surgery by a general ophthalmologist. Some patients have already undergone the same surgery by ENT surgeons also without diagnosing the case of canaliculitis. And still, that's how I said that the patient even if he is receiving different types of antibiotics, the discharge is continuing. So patient is always unhappy. And the message I want to deliver to the general ophthalmologist or the treating the first primary surgeon is to diagnose the condition clinically. And it is very easy to manage by themselves also. But if it is not manageable, the immediate referral to expert is advised.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Did you find any cicatrization there and the blockage of the canaliculus post-surgical?
No, I didn't found the single case in which the canal grow fibrosis.
May I request Dr. Satyam Gupta to please present his paper.
Good afternoon, everyone. My topic of discussion is stones that discharge. In a man's life, the most important question and he fears of is a female tearing, a female crying. So the problem is watering and lacrimation with discharge. And the solution of the problem starts with the answer of a simple question: whom to consult? And the obvious answer is oculoplastic people, who are the champions, for whom treating lacrimal issues is like playing guitar. But the scenario is never the same. I am presenting an interesting case report of a 67-year-old female who presented to our OPD with complaint of painful swelling over the medial side of the upper lid in the left eye, along with watering and discharge. These are the clinical photographs of the patient on presentation. Kindly note the swelling over the medial side of the upper lid in the left eye. She was being treated elsewhere for these complaints, but since she was not relieved, the case was referred to our hospital in the oculoplasty department. There is no history of any systemic illness. On examination, there is tender swelling in the left upper canalicular area, pouting of upper punctum with discharge. The lower punctum appears normal. She was diagnosed with a case of chronic canaliculitis with superimposed secondary infection, leading to formation of localized abscess. After routine investigations and physician clearance, surgical exploration was planned. Under all aseptic precautions and local anesthesia, incision and drainage was done. Postoperatively, she was started on systemic antibiotic, anti-inflammatory drugs, along with topical antibiotic. These are the clinical photographs of the patient postoperative following incision and drainage. The patient appears absolutely normal. After 4 months, she again presented to us with epiphora and discharge. There are clinical photographs of the patient when she again presented to us with watering and discharge. Now, what's next? And a million-dollar advice is to follow the basics. We again evaluated the patient and the history of recurrence was present. Previous episode was 8 months back. No history of any systemic stone formation, neither renal nor biliary. On examination, she was Roplast test positive. Lacrimal sac syringing revealed NLD obstruction. And for this, an external DCR surgery is planned as per the protocol. To our surprise, during the surgery, we found multiple stones of different size, shape, consistency, and appearance in the lacrimal sac. The sac was explored for complete removal of stones. This is a clinical photograph of dacrolith, which can be small or big, rough and smooth, opaque and translucent, and lobulated. The patient was kept on systemic antibiotics under regular follow-up and was asymptomatic since then. These are the clinical photographs of the patient post-operative after dacrocystor anastomy and dacrolith removal. This is an endoscopic photograph of the same. You can see the implant in place and the patient is doing absolutely well. To summarize, we have presented a case of canalicular and lacrimal sac dacrolithiasis, which was initially diagnosed in abscess in the left upper canalicular area, and definitive diagnosis was made only during the curative surgery, that is external dacrocystor anastomy. Dacrolith are calculi of protein and cellular debris formed in the lacrimal system. The etiopathogenesis is unclear, but some form of epithelial metaplasia and alteration of mucin and trefoil factor peptide has been noted. They can be broadly classified as infectious and non-infectious. Dacrolithiasis most commonly affects lacrimal sac, rarely canaliculus, and hardly nasolacrimal duct. It often presents as epiphora along with swelling over the area of involvement. Discharge and pouting of the punctum may also be present and should arouse suspicion. They are usually found in conjunction with intermittent or chronic dacrocystitis. Lacrimal sac syringing reveals resistance or regurgitation. Investigation modalities include dacrocystography, B scan, CT scan, dacroendoscopy. However, in large number of patients, the definitive diagnosis is made during a dacrocystoanostomy, which also serves as the cure. So to conclude, dacrolithiasis is a relatively common disorder that is often underdiagnosed due to unavailability and unaffordability of the required imaging modalities. Take-home message is, although in most of the cases, dacroliths are an incidental finding during DCR surgery, certain clinical features, such as epiphora with swelling over canalicular or medial canthal area, should arouse high index of suspicion. These are my references. Thank you very much. And thank you to my mentors, Dr. Mehul Shah and Dr. Shreya Shah.
Any questions from the judges?
Yeah, so were the stones analyzed, the chemical composition?
No, sir. Actually, we don't have that facility available to in the area we are working. So
that would have given us a clue to, you know.
Were the calculi palpable in any form, in any swelling?
Sir, actually when the patient presented to us, she was having a redness with discharge, acute red kind of canaliculus. We just go through the incision drainage. At that time, we didn't take the proper history of the episode she was having previously. So last episode was 8 months back. When she presented again to us, then we inquired in detail what was the status and then, but the stones were not palpable in the sac area. They were not palpable.
Two statements I could not agree. One is that you will care only for the watery females. You will not care for the males with epiphora. And second one, dacrolith is common because it's a very rare, I mean, encounter for me. And I have done over 7,000 dacrocystoranostomy. Over 7,000 dacrocystoranostomy. I have got only three cases where I found a stone there. So that particular statement probably I cannot accept.
That's okay. It is a very rare condition. But I would like your opinion on the first statement.
Yes.
Which you did not agree with. What is your statement instead?
Statement is that he is not caring for the male suited people.
So we are on the second side, now.
The males who are crying, you didn't tell what they should do. No?
So this is at best is a good case study, that's all, not a good paper.
Any question from the audience?
Malik, what
did
you say?
Thank you,
sir. Thank you.
So that ends the session. We had two speakers absent and our keynote address was not there.
No.
So I thank Dr. A.K. Grobar, Dr. Mandeep Singh Bajaj, and Dr. Parveen Kumar Mangre to be with me here. And we had very good presentations. I request Dr. A.K. Grobar to give an overall submission.
So thank you. This has been a very educative session, except for the disagreement over whether female tears are more important or the male tears. So there were some innovations which were particularly useful and some new insights based on the surgical experience of some of our surgeons, and I'm sure we are all enriched by the session. We'll be handing over the marks to the scientific committee who will collate them and let you know the results. Thank you very much for audience participation and for all my co-chairpersons for their active participation. Thank you very much. And we take pride in handing over to the next session before time. We took over about 40 minutes late.
Because two speakers are not.
Four speakers.